Welcome back to After the Fact. I'm Christian Esguera. Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte is holding a special meeting to discuss Russia's continued aggression against Ukraine. It's attended by cabinet members, uniformed forces, and the business sector. The chief executive urges the public to keep an eye out on the outcome of the discussions, since he believes Filipinos don't have a good grasp of the situation yet. Online, some netizens welcomed the move, even though it happened on day 6 of the invasion. Others are curious to find out the insights of Duterte, who previously called Russian leader Vladimir Putin his idol. We're now joined by Professor Francis Domingo. He is the vice chairman of the Department of International Studies at De La Salle University. Good evening, sir, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Good evening, Christian. Good evening to your viewers, and thank you for having me.
Okay, you've been following this this issue. I understand for the past several years. Before we go into the nitty-gritty of this very complicated issue, I'd like to get your thoughts regarding this special meeting called by President Duterte after the Philippine government, the Department of Foreign Affairs, actually backed the UN General Assembly resolution condemning the Russian invasion or Putin's invasion of Ukraine. Help us make sense of that.
Well, I think he needed to respond, because the United Nations had a special meeting, a General Assembly, just for this current situation. So perhaps the lag, you mentioned it took a while, it's because he had close ties, trying to have at least close ties with Russia. So it's not that simple that you just abandon those ties. But I think he was, he needed to respond. He needed to act on the vote of the Philippines, which is to denounce what's happening in Russia.
But then again, the Philippines already cast its vote in support of the UN's resolution. So what, can the president actually change anything regarding that?
I think he didn't initiate the meeting before the vote, right? So I was monitoring it. So again, he had to respond to the vote because we already have a vote. So I mean, it's very hard to make out, what they're discussing, obviously. Mm-hmm. But the point is, we have a position. Our position is denouncing what's happening in Ukraine. So we need, he needs perhaps, what's the next steps. If we denounced it, what's the next?
Okay. And of course, before the Philippine position was made known, before the UN General Assembly, candidates for president, for example, had been asked about their position regarding the issue. And we heard certain candidates say that the Philippines should stay neutral. Talking about the Philippines as a responsible member of the international community and the UN, was that really a viable option to stay stay neutral in the face of Russian aggression against Ukraine?
I don't think it's a viable option for two reasons. So we do have OFWs, for example, it's the first one in Ukraine, so we have national interest there. So I think we have 372, I think, or 370.
380, plus.
So,
I think.
380. So can you be neutral if one of those, I understand one of ROWs in the ships, I think in the ship, was injured. So can you stay neutral if your citizens are in harm's way? And the second, we also have, relations with diplomatic relations with Ukraine. So how's that going to play? So you need to make hard decisions when it comes to the next way forward.
Okay. Now, it's been several days since Putin decided to invade Ukraine, and we saw different sanctions coming from many different countries, including members of the EU, sanctions imposed on Russia. Help us understand what Putin can reasonably still achieve at this stage, and talk to us about this possible endgame.
Great. Great question. No, I mean, I haven't seen any, so I'm not an expert on Russian studies or Ukraine studies, but I've been trying to attend all these discussions, and I haven't seen any definite word on what really Putin really wants. Now, there are different perspectives. One is, he obviously views Ukraine as what, a partner. So he would like the Ukraine to be in his orbit, meaning Russian orbit, more than the West. So that's one, you know, he stated this in his July 2021 article he posted on the Russian president's website, right? So it was a long article, around maybe 15 pages, talking about unity, historical unity between Ukraine and Russia. So that's one, you know, there are other perspectives. That's one that he doesn't really consider Ukraine as, you know, as he doesn't accept, Ukraine under the, you know, the West, more than aligned with the West rather than being independent. He calls it independent, but closer to perhaps Russia. So the end game is something I've been, you know, that's been really puzzling me, because at the moment, Christian, I don't see any acceptable end game here, meaning people will unfortunately die, you know, whatever scenario you're looking at. That's the most, I think, the toughest and the most painful, you know, situation to accept. Perhaps, you know, we can, you know, hypothesize a breakthrough in peace talks, but so far, you know, round one, I think they met round one, nothing conclusive. So, you know, that's the best case scenario, perhaps a breakthrough with peace talks between Ukraine and Russia. But I'm not really very optimistic when it comes to that, because he already invaded Ukraine.
Yeah, since he actually decided to put boots on the ground and attack a neighbor with whom they have very close cultural ties and, of course, history, very much intertwined. If you're Putin, how do you extract yourself out of this with any measure of grace, for lack of a better word? Or if he decides to push this further, how far do you think is he willing to go?
Well, I don't think so. You mentioned grace. I don't think that's, you know, that's in the discussion anymore.
Because, or save face.
Saving face. Well, I don't, to be honest, no. Given his track record in the past 20 years, 22 years, right? So you can actually plot a number of what they call active measures, the Russians call, you know, active measures that they've been conducting around the world, including assassinations, special operations in Syria. So he already has a strong track record. So I think saving face is probably not one of his objectives at this point. Power projection is obviously one of his objectives, but based on reports, no, the Russian military is underperforming, quote unquote. No? So I heard that General David Petraeus on CNN, for example, that's how he characterized it. But what we're seeing now is really a limited war, what we call a limited war. They're not using the full capacity or the all the instruments of their, you know, military industrial complex yet. So this is, to be honest, it's very scary. It's very, you know, it's very disturbing, you know, what they can do with the full capacity. Right. So
yeah, with the limited war, I mean, what do you think is his objective in this limited war that you described? Well, because obviously a lot of people underestimated Ukraine. They're actually putting up a very tough resistance. But again, in the face of a limited war, kumbaga, Russia has not actually unleashed yet the full arsenal.
I think the best assessment, you know, is to look at assessment is to look at 2008 Georgia, Russia, Georgia, and then the annexation of Crimea in 2014. There are similarities with the operations that they conducted. So probably what they may do would be take areas of, they've already taken Donbass and Crimea. They could add to that and stop there for now. But the problem is they invaded, so maybe they need to get the entire, you know, territory. Because if they were, you know, like, there was really no significant challenge when the annexation of Crimea happened.
Yeah.
So so they can't do the same playbook, but there are similar operations using disinformation, cyber, and then of course psychological operations. Same, you know, similar methods in this case, but they need probably to, you know, I don't know if it's a win, you know, take the entire territory type of situation, but I'm sure they can't repeat the same the same, they don't have the same objectives at this point because they already invaded.
Mm-hmm. Domestically, do you see public opinion playing any significant role in the Putin administration's decision making? Because it's the Russian people, most of them, who have been unfairly bearing the brunt of the sanctions because of the actions of their leader. And of course, tanggalin natin mga oligarchs who have been closely associated with Putin. So nararamdaman din nila yung epekto ng sanctions. But the ordinary Russians and their opinion, do you think that could have any significant effect on the decision of their leaders?
Well, to be honest, I'm still saying no, because of his network and machinery in Russia, right? So that's the best. I mean, I was hoping, maybe they could, an overthrow, perhaps, But we've been discussing that for what, we have experts discussing that since 2014,
yeah.
Right? So the machinery I'm talking about is that in the business sector and even in the civil society, he has a network. Right. So meaning whether it's former FSB or former military generals that were, allied to him. So it's very difficult to imagine that he hasn't anticipated a civil war and overthrow. So knowing that he was able to wait for, 8 years for this?
Yeah.
Right. So why now? It's been 8 years, so he's probably not probably, but it's clear that he's prepared in terms of domestic consideration. Of course, you could still have some surprises. Like I'm sure he didn't anticipate the resistance of Ukraine. At this point.
How about the sanctions? Because Putin is a known strategist, very mysterious as well. So it would be reasonable to believe that he had actually anticipated how the West would respond. That they would not actually put boots on the ground in Ukraine, but they would supply arms and come up with different sanctions.
Yeah, so you have, again, different perspectives on that. But if we look at 2014 and the annexing of Crimea, they did economic sanctions, not as severe, but obviously it didn't work. So I'm not saying it's not going to work now, but I think, given that he's anticipated, these sanctions, right? What possible, what outcome, will the West and United States anticipate or expect, given that they've been doing the, imposing sanctions for the past couple of years? So probably doing the most severe sanctions, but so you're probably wanting to mobilize the Russian people against Putin. But again, if he's anticipated that, it's going to be a scenario where you're going to have, people dying again, papakulong yan or violence, domestically. So it's, as I mentioned, Christian, it's, unfortunately very, the outcome is not very, I don't see any acceptable outcome at this point. Acceptable
for
meaning,
wala
sanang mamamatay, oh yes.
For either side, of course, this is a war, so nobody actually wins in a war.
Yes,
you only have losers.
Yes,
pero
yes.
Well, dito, if the sanctions, however severe and sustained they may be, if they don't work, they don't drive the Russians away from Ukraine, what are the other options you think the West would or might explore?
So yeah, so I mentioned already too. So perhaps, let's try to be optimistic, breakthrough in negotiations. That's one. Overthrow domestic factors coming into play, perhaps, trying to create a situation where Putin will step down. And the third one, but of course it involves some escalation, is, intervention by whether the, Europeans are involving the US, but the US has already mentioned that they're not going to deploy. Right, but yeah, that's external intervention, right? So that right now what they're doing is they're sending a lot of weapons, a lot of money, a lot of specialized military equipment, but eventually they've been sending proxies, meaning, so for instance, I saw a item in the UK, for example, that they are private contractors who wanting to join, for instance. So those will be paid discreetly, but they're not officially representing a state. So that could be, you know, what we're going to see in the next few weeks or so.
Similar to what we saw in Iraq, but there were private contractors. And of course, Putin is also known to send his mercenaries and saboteurs. Yes, so it's really a very interesting conflict, but one that is, of course, whatever side you look at it, from whatever side you look at it, it's very, very unfortunate. So you don't see any... Putin actually also put his nuclear forces on high alert. Is it simply saber rattling, or knowing him, might actually push this further?
Well, it's signaling, right? So that's what nuclear powers do, right? So North Korea is, of course, they're you know, out of touch, no, with the world really. But that's signaling. So Putin is demonstrating in Suzov, no, brinkmanship, right? That he's signaling that, you know, if, you know, he respond, according to him, is responding to NATO's threats. That's why he put these strategic forces on high alert. And he did that, and he actually did the same thing. So similar exercises before he actually deployed. So it's a signal. Of course, NATO responded by saying we also have nuclear weapons. So we have two. So UK and France have both have nuclear weapons. But see, so while I think it's, you know, the situation is dire, and I don't see a acceptable outcome here, I am not willing to speculate that he will use nuclear weapons, because that's, I can't even fathom the situation. So that's, I think it's a signaling move for Putin that, you know, I can evade, I can also test nuclear weapons while invading, right? So, you know, if you can threaten me, I can threaten you as well.
Of course, so, officially, Putin had been saying this. He wanted this question solved or answered very clearly now, that Ukraine shouldn't join NATO. Sinasabi niya, although their analysts are saying na there's more to that than just than that particular issue. Do you see any unintended consequence here that this might actually lead to Ukraine joining this alliance, the security alliance, because of the realities that they are seeing now? Or that, of course, the West would still be more quote-unquote prudent in terms of dealing with a superpower like Russia, especially under Putin, and they won't go to that extent of actually embracing Ukraine as part of that security alliance?
Difficult to say, but I guess the West would be prudent, because see, the issue here is really, so, you know, there's a lot to unpack or explore here. You can go back to the end of the Cold War, but you know, with the NATO enlargement. But think about this: since 2017, how many states that are near adjacent to Russia have joined NATO, right? I can think of three, four. So why in the past 5 years, or sorry, since 2017? So, you know, I'm not obviously, you know, Putin is, as you mentioned, you know, a strategist, so he can, you know, he can make these statements. But, you know, if you join NATO, you know, that's, if Ukraine joins NATO, that's, you know, that's an inevitable conflict. I don't know how it's going to end, because that's already at the border, literally, of Russia, and so they have Belarus as well, right? And you have the other states, you know, Baltic states joining NATO. So lahat yun, no, all of them will be part of NATO. Russia will never accept that. I haven't seen any scholar analyst that has mentioned that Russia will ever accept, you know, Ukraine joining NATO. So it's inevitable conflict once again, assuming that this conflict war has been resolved. So West wouldn't risk that. Again, very difficult to say, because we don't know the outcome.
Yeah.
You know, for all you know, let's take positive, no? Putin stepped down. Perhaps, no, an overthrow, we don't know. But that's, you know, I mean, other analysts would probably, or experts would disagree with me, and you know, that's not going to happen. So that's why, you know, joining NATO will only have, you know, will only encourage more conflict, because Russia will never allow it.
Okay. Professor Francis Domingo, thank you for joining us tonight on the program.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me. Thank you.
So that's it for tonight. This has been your host, Christian Esguerra. You can watch this episode again on I Want TFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. Now for recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel and catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again tomorrow after the fact.